Haben Sie da? Counting da.
Oh, what was it? Sorry.
It's okay. Counting the cost.
Cost of being in the security industry.
Okay, cool. So you're working for the security industry. So when you think when I think of the word security, it's like those people that come to the ATM with the guns in there. Right next to their, like right here on the side, on their
On their
hip,
hip.
on their, yeah, on their hip. So, and not many people know, and those people that come when somebody break into your house. So that's something that people would normally associate the word security with. So, what is your current job?
So I'm currently employed for the Department of Defense here at Camp Humphreys. I work in the construction security industry. So basically, that entails controlling the access and also the building of government buildings that are secured, that are built for the purpose of having secret conversations, conversations that shouldn't be privy to any enemies or even within allies of the United States government. There's things that the government likes to call compartmentalizing, keeping it so that only a small group of people know what's happening. It's also known as need to know.
Oh, I see. So, what made you decide to go on that route?
So for me, I kind of fell into this portion of the security industry. I'll start where I first started in security, which was I started in armed security at Vandenberg Air Force Base in California back in 2011. I had a buddy that had a security training company, and he said, "Hey, I heard Vandenberg's hiring for security officers." At the time, I was looking at going into law enforcement. I wanted to join the California Highway Patrol in California. But due to budget restraints, I was not able to get on with them. So I saw this as another opportunity to do, let's say, my part. I joined the, I got hired on with a company called Chenega as an armed security officer. From there, it was a one, it was a 2-year contract, and we had to move over to Department of the Air Force civilian police officers. So I technically did serve as a police officer for 90 days, but I'm not a sworn officer.
Wow.
So I cannot walk around and say I'm a police officer, because I only served in the title, but not as a sworn police officer.
Wow. That's crazy.
So from there, I worked for SpaceX. I think I mentioned to you, I did a little bit of work at SpaceX, just basic security work, handing IDs, allowing access to the site, and roving patrols. And then I ended up in Japan doing similar work to what I was doing with SpaceX, just checking doors, making sure building was secure. And that's how from there, I ended up coming to Korea in 2016. So I've been in the security industry now 9 years.
Wow. So, do you feel sometimes stressed because you have to guard something secretive? Or does that make you feel like you're always being targeted? How do you feel?
Right. So, yes, and no. We all receive training. We all do hours of training yearly. We try to maintain, do continuing education as other industries do. So we also are not, we are also aware that we are targets, and one of the main reasons why we are in the positions that we're at is to mitigate the risk. So in the industry that I work in, we talk about security in depth. You've got concentric circles that just move out from a specific point that you're, let's say, I'm guarding. And as those rings get bigger, the risk, if you have a five rings around one object, it's more than likely that object is pretty safe. If you have less rings, then it's more likely that there's more risk. And it just depends on where you're at. Like, for example, I'm at Camp Humphreys. It's a military base guarded by Korean National Security guards at the gates and military personnel, military police driving around the base. So relatively, the site that I'm at is relatively safe. The risk is low, but still, they find it necessary to have personnel like me there to make sure that the building isn't compromised, and that the integrity of the building is there for when the end user, whoever ends up using that building, has the clarity of mind that and the security to know that their building is built well, and it's they don't have to worry about the conversations that they're having inside those spaces.
Wow. So, you mentioned that you are working for a church also for the security purpose, and you're also working for this regular security company. So how do you relate to them differently?
Okay, so I don't currently work for the, so I worked for the California Conference of Seventh-day Adventists during the summers,
okay.
During camp meeting, mm-hmm. and we would do armed security for those events.
Okay.
It's a little bit different because of who you're interacting with.
Yeah.
I would talk to my coworkers because I'd be dually employed. I'd be employed through, let's say, the base, and then I would be employed during the summer by the conference.
Yeah.
And when that would happen, my coworkers would ask me, why do you need to have security at a church event? Like, what are you guys doing there? Like, what's going on? So I had to explain to them that even though it is a church function, it is a open public function. And we live in the United States, we live in California, where any number of different types of people drive by the camp meeting and or come inside the camp meeting. So it was our chief of guard, he always said that the reason why he pushed for armed security at the camp meeting was so that the people that went there were safe and that they were not made or allowed to be victims if and when something happened. We see the shooting at that church in Texas where a person concealed carrying was able to take out that perpetrator, that person that was shooting up the church. And that was also one of the reasons why our chief of guard, he really wanted that as many as could did carry. Also, it's camp meeting. There's a lot of money that's passing hands through offering collection, tithe collection. So just on one Sabbath, you could have $250,000 in the possession of the deacons or the people collecting the offering. That's a lot of money, and that's a huge target. So during those times, we would set up on all the entrances to the auditorium to make sure that it was a controlled environment and that that money was making its way to where it needed to go, to the church hall.
Wow, that's a lot of money. How many people gather there?
There was it could range between 7,000 and 12,000 people on Sabbath.
That's a lot of money.
So it's just imagine it's a small city. It's the size of a small California city, and so we were charged with not only security, first aid, any type of firefighting effort that we needed to do. A lot of the firefighters came from the PUC Angwin area, but we were there to assist in whatever crowd control, traffic control, making sure that the people that went there to worship were there, were able to do so, and were safe.
Wow.
I don't know. Do you know who Jose Rojas is?
Oh, Pastor.
Pastor Jose Rojas.
I think I've heard of him.
He's the guy with the big mustache.
Oh, the funny guy.
The really funny guy. So He used to be a pastor at the Central California Conference in Fresno, California. But because of his interaction with gang members, he baptized a lot of gang members and took out a lot of people out of gang life. He still has death threats after more than 30 to 40 years out of the city of Fresno. So every time that he makes his way to camp meeting, I was there 1 year and we had to do executive protection. Executive protection is basically being a bodyguard for a person. So we had to literally post up and follow him everywhere he went because of the threats he still had against his life.
So he used to be a gang member?
He was not a gang member, but he was baptizing gang members. He was in the city of a couple of the cities there in what's called the Central Valley, from Bakersfield all the way up to Fresno. And so he was doing the Lord's work and baptizing, converting and baptizing gang members. And obviously gang leaders don't like when their followers are leaving them because they're the breadwinners. So.
Wow. So even for the religious church event, security is a must if the crowd is big.
If the crowd is big, the thing about it though is the public has access, so the public can come in without us. We're not checking membership cards like Costco. If you want to come hear the word, you're coming to hear the word. But there's that possibility that a person that is being possessed by the devil could come into the camp meeting and try to harm or cause destruction. That happened. I was given an example where I actually saw this. A gentleman came into the auditorium and it was actually one of the years that Jose Rojas spoke, and he stood at the very edge of the pulpit of the platform. And all of a sudden you see him just get onto the platform and try to get at Jose Rojas. But one of the security officers was able to come up behind him. And as he was about to put his hands on the pastor, he grabbed him by his jacket and just let him right off on the other side, just walked him off stage. That's one of many stories that I've heard of things that have happened there at Canyon.
What was it trying to do exactly?
At the time, I was just a camper, so I don't know what happened. I don't know the interactions that they did. But the only thing I can assume is that he was not there to have a friendly conversation with the pastor.
Oh, okay. So he was trying to harm him, and somebody stopped him. And so he did his job, and as a result, the pastor was safe.
Right.
Wow. Oh, let's talk about the scope of the industry, because I didn't notice security is everywhere, but when you actually mentioned about the crucial role of security for our daily lives, I think it's everywhere. So what are the areas that security is involved?
You have physical security, which is someone allowing or preventing you access to a specific building or to a vehicle. You have technology security. Companies employ hundreds of people to try to help to prevent hacks, prevent your PII, your personal information, from getting out onto the web, onto the dark web. And I don't know how it is here in Korea, but in the United States, if someone were to get a hold of my driver's license number and my personal identifier number, which is my social security number, they could start accounts, credit, open up credit cards, and other information. So there's people have lost. People spend millions of dollars trying to protect their identity, and sometimes that's not even enough. Sometimes it does happen. I receive letters from my banks, from my credit cards, that say, "Hey, we're sorry that this happened, but somebody breached our servers, and they may have your information. Please be careful." So, and the industry that I'm in, what I'm in is more physical security as well, to be concluded, not construction security. But the main ones are physical and technology.
Oh. So did you have a special interest when you were a child?
So as a child, I was all over the place. I was a roller coaster for what I wanted to do when I grew up. It's, you end up going to the doctor's office. You're like, I want to be a pediatrician. You go to the dentist office. Yeah, I want to be a dentist. You go to a really good revival series. I want to be a pastor. So ultimately, when I graduated high school and I went to college, I actually went there for I was an agriculture major. I was a crop science major at the time. Unfortunately, my grades did not reflect what I was learning, and I was forced to leave school. But I on my way to school one day, I actually saw the bumper sticker for a California Highway Patrol officer that said that they were hired. It said CHP Careers, I think it was called. And so I started looking at law enforcement. That piqued my interest. And from when I left the university, I went to a local college and was looking at what's called administration of justice. It would have been a associate's degree, and then I would have transferred to a four-year university to get a criminal justice degree. So for me, my foot into the security industry was through law enforcement, wanting to be an asset to my community, either as a police officer or as a correctional officer. But ultimately, I've decided I've left the U.S., so right now I'm doing what's called construction security.
You know, when I was a teenager or a child, I just thought that teachers were having a good time with children. They were making an impact. They were making an impact on young minds, and it's a stable job. So I always admired teachers. So do you have any exemplary people that influenced you to go on that route, or did you read the books, or did you listen to any YouTube channel, or who influenced you to
join for the security industry?
Yeah,
I wouldn't necessarily say somebody specifically.
Okay.
The only person I can think of that comes to the top of my mind is my friend, the one that I was working selling cell phones when I met him. I met him at my little kiosk inside of Costco. Sparked up a conversation. He liked what he called my demeanor. He said, "Sam, you have commanding presence. You could do good in this industry."
Wow.
So I'd probably say my buddy Carl was a person that probably influenced me to get into the security industry. He himself had been in security for a while. He worked different contracts. I was actually able to bring him on to do security with the church. And he's still doing every summer. He goes faithfully to SoCal, California, which is near Santa Cruz, and he does security work for the Seventh Day Adventist Church. I don't know. I'm hoping he's possibly hearing some of the sermons. maybe by osmosis. You know, just passively receiving information. But I'd probably say that he was the person that really influenced me. On security work.
Oh, that's very, very interesting. So your friend saw a potential in you, and your personality was just exuding that security person. So so he said you have this commanding presence. So let's go back to your childhood. So what do you think shaped you into that kind of person?
I don't think I wouldn't say anything in my childhood is really what shaped me into that. Maybe you want to look at it as kind of sad, but I've become a very dark person since I've gotten into this industry. And I actually have to kind of push myself into a happier place. Because of the type of work that you do, you sometimes start only seeing the worst in people.
Oh.
Because law enforcement, security work, you're seeing threats. You see people doing bad things, as we want to label them. I've gotten into fistfights because of my work. Trying to take somebody into custody is not always glamorous. It's not always a nice pressed uniform. Sometimes it can get very, very difficult and dangerous. So,
wow.
I think I kind of pushed myself into commanding presence, kind of watching cop shows. You know, there's a very famous show in the States called Cops. They've since taken it down because of what's happened in the last couple of years with law enforcement interaction. But just you watch it enough, you start walking like that, talking like that.
Oh, I see. So I guess you just had that atmosphere around you as a person, and then as you went into the industry, you had to try really hard to stay positive, not just thinking those dark things all the time. But I can't really, really relate to you, because I went to a prison to talk to the prison guards to take initiative of any ministry for my church. And he said, don't even try on these people. They're not going to change. And he said, I've been working for this prison, for many prisons, for 20 years or 30 years, and I've never seen anybody being changed. So he said something very straight up discouraging to me, that don't even try on these people. They're not going to change. And so he sounded very disillusioned with all these people. So do you have any positive encounter or stories or any expression of appreciation that you've heard from anybody while you were?
All right, let me see. Usually it's from your leadership. Usually it's from your superiors. For us, it's usually things that we find. I have this one coworker that I don't remember I worked with. This guy had an amazing, amazing nose. He was able to find so much weed, so much cannabis while we were working together. He had, on the 2 years that I worked with him, he had 3 busts. And these weren't like simple, like, I mean, these things were hidden, and he was able to find them. And I was very impressed with that. But even me describing this, I'm describing a good event about something bad. So it's not always. The only thing I mean, I've never had these encounters because it wasn't part of what happened around me. But I can only imagine that some security guards or some security professionals have had to either rescue somebody from some sort of emergency situation, so like either first aid, render first aid, or some sort of fire or something like that. My biggest relief has always been the security, especially like at camp meeting, was the security and the safety of the people that were there. That gave me great pride to make sure that my fellow Christians, my fellow Seventh-day Adventists were able to go into their meetings and being able to worship God and have that peace of mind that they didn't have to worry about what was going on outside of that building. But they were able to concentrate on whatever the speaker was saying and being able to listen and allow the Spirit to work in their lives. And I also know that me being safe myself was because of God's work and the Holy Spirit working and taking care of all of us officers that were there that were armed.
Wow.
And,
so how many similarities would you find between police officers and security guards and whatever you've been involved? How much training does it involve? How much does it lapse? Overlap?
There's a lot that does lapse. One of the biggest things that we sometimes have to remind the public is we're not law enforcement. We are like you. When I'm in a security uniform, I'm the same as you. I have no additional arresting powers than a common citizen. So in the United States, they have something called citizen's arrest, and that's basically the arrest that I have. If I've seen a felony being committed or a misdemeanor being committed in my presence, I can then take action and take that person into custody, either by force or by verbal, just saying, you're under arrest, you can't leave until the authorities arrive. I also have, that's a great responsibility when you do that, because you can be sued for false imprisonment or kidnapping. Because the moment you tell that person they can't leave or you try to restrain them, you are now, it's you have to be very sure what you're doing before you do that. Because the United States is a very sue-happy country, as is Korea.
Oh, so you think Koreans sue people as many as Americans do?
I think so.
Oh, really?
Yes, especially in, well, the what I've seen is the auto. This is the only country, aside from Japan, that I've visited where you're at fault if you get hit by somebody else. I don't understand that.
Oh, you have to also pay part of the injury or damage if you're getting
hit. Yes. Yes. To me, I'm sorry, but that does not make any sense to me. That's a tangent. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I don't know how that works either. I guess there should be a rationale behind it.
I'll just say this briefly. In Japan, when I was there, they basically looked at it as, if you weren't in my country, I wouldn't have hit you, so you need to pay because I hit you.
Oh, I see. So if a Japanese or Korean national hits you as a driver, you will also have to pay for your own injury.
Yes, and their injury.
And their injury.
Right.
That's too ridiculous. I've never thought about that. Never happened to me. Hope it doesn't happen.
So I tell all my coworkers, make sure you don't get in an accident.
Make sure these things that has nothing to do with you doesn't come to you. Yeah. Yeah. So when you compare police officers and civilian and you as a security person, so does that mean I can also say you can't leave until the police officer came? I can say stuff like that also.
In the United States, if you see a crime, a misdemeanor, or a felony, you see somebody assault somebody. You see somebody steal from somebody. If you saw it in your presence, and you decide to take action, you could put that person under citizen's arrest. You could arrest them and prevent them from leaving until the proper authorities are up.
Would you be punished if you were inactive? Had been inactive?
So in the United States, I don't know about here in Korea, but in the United States, there's no requirement to. There's no requirement to arrest somebody.
Okay.
If you see a crime being committed, you are not a police officer. If a crime happens in the presence of a police officer, because they are what's called a mandated reporter, they have to act. There's no choice. They have to act. As a private citizen, you do not have to act. And that goes the same for security guards. You do not have to act.
But if the case gets worse because of your inactivity as a citizen, would that be a problem? Would you be punished?
No.
Oh, really?
No. Because I have no requirement to make myself liable. If I decide to act, that sets me up for liability, that I will become liable for whatever outcome comes. If someone gets killed, if somebody gets hurt, somebody loses property, or whatever happens, that now I've put me into that situation. Now I'm liable for that. There's no requirement for you to become liable.
No, okay.
The same way in the United States, there's no requirement for me to render aid in a first aid scenario.
Okay.
But in the United States, they do have something called the Good Samaritan Law. So if you decide to act, and in the process of you acting, helping out, rendering aid, that person dies, if you are not negligent, you'll be covered, that you cannot be pursued criminally. That does not mean that you cannot be pursued civilly. They can still come after your money. But you just won't go to jail.
Oh, I see. So if you cause more damage because of your ignorance in medical knowledge, is that going to be a problem?
Yes, it would be a problem because you've surpassed your knowledge. You're doing something that's out of, so if, let's say, for example, I took a first aid class and they taught us to immobilize the neck, they taught us certain things, but hey, they didn't teach me to insert a catheter. I have no knowledge of how to do that and I should not attempt that. That should be done by a medical professional. So I could be sued for that, for taking steps to something that I did not know, had no knowledge of.
Okay, so even if you knew how to do certain medical procedures or any first aid or anything simple, because you watched the YouTube video multiple times, if you do it wrong, you can be punished or you can be liable.
Right, because even though you have your YouTube history saying that you watched that, does not mean that you learned it properly.
Oh,
So you have no medical certificate that states that you know how to do X, Y, and Z.
I see. So, if a 11-year-old or a 17-year-old decide to pursue security industry, what is the first thing they need to do?
So the first thing they would need to do is basically go to Google and Google what the requirements in their city, the province, and their state.
Okay.
So I grew up in the state of California, and in there they have it's called a security officer course. It's a 40-hour course that you have to take before you're able to do any type of security work. As soon as you've completed that course, you take a test, and now those results get sent to the state of California. They send you back what's called a guard card. The guard card allows you to exercise security work or find security work. So if I go to an employer that's advertising for security guards, that's one of the first things they're going to ask me. They'll be like, show me your driver's license, your social security card, and your guard card, because we need that to make sure that you have the 40 hours, the knowledge, because if not, they become liable and they can get sued for hiring somebody that is just playing security guard and doesn't actually have the knowledge of security work.
Does that mean 40-hour course that you take and the certification or getting license to serve work in that capacity, there is no differentiation between a security guard that's going to guard the president of the United States and the guard that is going to work at the apartment complex?
So, yes and no. So, security guards don't guard the President of the United States. They're law enforcement officers. They're police officers. They're secret agents. They're special agents.
A special agent,
So
okay.
they are full-fledged law enforcement. They go to law enforcement academies. So they're kind of in a different
Oh, okay.
spectrum. If I might make a little bit of a difference or a comparison, I think where you were trying to go with was a comparison of a Ajashi that works down at the parking entrance,
Yeah, exactly.
compared to, let's say, the guy that comes around for Worry Bank with their
Oh
money,
yeah,
right?
okay.
So that'd be the training. The initial training is similar,
Okay.
because you have to have in the United States, they all have to have that guard card.
Okay.
You then get specialized training. So the person down at the parking entrance does not need a gun,
Okay.
so they will not get gun training. That's an additional course, an additional 40 hours or you have to take,
Okay.
and then you have to do continuous training to maintain your skills, because shooting skills are perishable. If you don't practice, you may think, oh yeah, I remember how to shoot. In a moment where you need to draw your gun and discharge your weapon, it's a whole different story.
So, yeah, that's crazy. Have you ever had a situation when you had to?
I've not had to draw my firearm, fortunately, thank God. But I have had to take out my my pepper spray, my mace,
wow.
And I was about to make a guy drink it. He was about to get sprayed. But aside from that, I deployed my baton, my steel baton, collapsible baton. You extend it out, and you use it to. It's more of a deterrent. I mean, if you have to start using it, it's gonna hurt somebody. But it's more of, once they see that baton in your hand, they become a little bit more compliant.
Have you ever inhaled, or have you ever experienced yourself?
Pepper spray? Yes. I had to, when I worked for the Air Force, I had to do a pepper spray. We had to see what the effects of pepper spray were on us, because you're armed. If you pepper spray somebody and the overspray hits you in the face, and there's a gust of wind, it's going to hit you straight in the face, and you will need to know how to react and how it affects you. In my class, the first kid that got pepper sprayed, his eyes literally just went, they shut. He was a pale kid from the South. I mean, he was paper white, and the poor kid just, his eyes were shut. He could not open them. They had to spray me twice. If you want later on, I can share the video with you. They had to spray me two times, because the first time I just opened up my eyes, I blinked open, and I looked at the guy that sprayed me. He's like, "All right, well, do it again." But let me see. But that scenario was a lot more of. We used like a bean bag, just trying to fight somebody off after you've been sprayed. You then have a shoot, no shoot scenario. So you come around the corner, you see a guy with a gun to his head, a gun, obviously this is training, and you have to decide what you're going to do. So you're under the effects of pepper spray. Your eyes are just hot, they're burning, it just hurts. And you have to act, because somebody's life can depend on it. So I holster my weapon and I... my training weapon, and I took care of the scenario. That did make me really hungry for tacos, though, afterwards. Little side note.
Wow. So it really confuses you, and it really, like, makes you really cry through your nostrils and eyes and everything.
It's not a fun feeling. It hurts. It does hurt.
Wow. That's crazy. So what are the, some sort of a hierarchy as to what is the next state, like a difficult one after the 40-hour training?
Like
you said, the law enforcement academy, you said?
So the law enforcement, that's an academy you apply to. Or some colleges allow you to put yourself through the academy. But normally you'd want to find a department that will hire you and put you through the academy, because while they're paying for the academy, they're also paying you. You get training pay. But instead of, like, if you put yourself through the academy, you have to save a good amount of money, because you're going to be in class and in the academy all day from 7 in the morning until 6 p.m. You're not going to be able to work, and you got to go home. You got to learn a lot of vehicle code, penal code. There's so many things you have to learn. So it's always good to have somebody hire you, because then you don't have to worry about income while you're going through the academy. But that is one thing you can do. I was looking at going into the correctional academy, because I was looking to become a correctional officer right before I left for Japan. I'd have been going to an academy for that. The state of California would pay for that. You can also put yourself through courses. There's a company called Gavin Becker. They're one of the largest and the most renowned executive protection companies. So they do a lot of bodyguarding for celebrities. So that's something else that you can put yourself through. There's always continuing education you can do. And there's always new types of training available, law enforcement, security, we all have our toys. We all have things that we just love to spend money on, and you're always looking at like, oh man, like, you look at each other's like belts, or we have our belts, and we're like, just like, oh, what do you got? Like, what did you buy? Or, oh, I want to get my taser. I want to get my taser cert now, or I want to get a better baton, or a new gun.
Wow. So Correctional Institute and the celebrity guarding and law enforcement. So law enforcement is specifically for police officers?
So a police officer is always law enforcement, but it's like, so how can I explain this? There's an absolute, like, police officers are always law enforcement, but security officers are not always law enforcement. Right? Like, police officers, they're a commissioned, they will always be police officers. So they're law enforcement. We are policy enforcement more than laws, because we're not. A lot of people actually misconstrue security officers to law enforcement, and they think that we can just arrest anybody. We can't, and we're actually supposed to, like, most courses that you go through for security work will tell you, you are observed and report. That's it. Most employers do not want the liability if you go hands-on with anybody.
Oh, I see.
I mean,
so, but you can use the gas thing.
You can, but it just depends on what your employer has insured themselves for, and what they're okay with you carrying. If, like, for example, at the camp meeting, they allowed me to carry a gun, but they did not want me to carry a thigh holster. So really tactical, just like, it's really easy to carry. They wanted it to be on my hip. So because of the type of license that the church had, I wasn't able to carry it like that. Even though it was just carrying a gun, it was just very simple, but they're like, sorry, Sam, you can't use that.
Oh, so there are different kinds of guns you can carry for different occasions?
Yeah. Well, there may be some employers that say you're unarmed, armed. You can carry a baton, you can carry pepper spray, you can carry the tasers. It just depends. Each employer will say, we're okay with you carrying this, or we want everybody to be uniform. And so this is what you are allowed to carry, and this, you can't use it.
So you know how to use all of them, taser and baton and...
I was never taser certified, so I've never fired a taser. I use
pepper spray,
baton. And firearm.
Firearm is actual gun.
Gun, yes.
What's the difference between baton and the other one?
Pepper spray?
Yeah.
So a baton is physical force. A pepper spray is a chemical reaction. So a chemical spray, pepper spray.
Baton is the actual this thing that you can hit people with?
Yes.
I thought it was some sort of gas.
No. A baton is pretty much a baseball bat. You are directing somebody and telling them, get on the ground or you are going to get hit.
Where are you supposed to hit?
So you have three zones that you can hit. Red, the head, obviously, you have your red zones, your yellow zones, and your green zones. Arms, legs, green zones. Abdomen, yellow. You really don't want to hit there. And then your upper chest and your head is your red. Those are the ones that you could kill somebody. If you hit somebody there, you could kill them. You could cause really, really bad bodily injury.
So how do you know which zone you're in?
I'll be hitting where I'm striking. So if I'm striking the person in the arm,
oh,
most
okay.
people, like, if you're gonna come down and try to strike somebody, they're usually gonna try to block. It's just human reaction.
Okay.
So that's usually where you want to hit them. I mean, it's gonna hurt, but it's not gonna.
Okay.
It's not gonna maim them. It's not gonna leave them paralyzed.
Oh, I see. I thought when you call them different zones, I thought you're talking about this area. This is red. This area is yellow. But you're talking about different parts of the body.
Different parts of the body. Sorry.
Okay. Wow. So, Taser is the electrically thing.
Yes, it's a less than lethal force device which can project some like they're called alligator clips. So basically, they inject into the body and they hold. And when you discharge the trigger, it produces an electrical current and immobilizes, in most part, and for most people, will immobilize the person and cause them to comply. All less than lethal or even brandishing a lethal weapon is to make someone comply, have them do what you want them to do.
Wow. Well, you don't have to go through that effect, right?
I did not. I did not, because at the time I want. Oh, did you get
Part of the
do you
training.
get tased?
Yeah.
Do you get is that your question? Do you get
Yeah,
tased?
yeah,
Usually it's not an actual projectile tasing, like they won't shoot the tase barbs into you, but they'll connect the alligator clips to your skin, and you'll go for what's called the ride. So if you go onto YouTube and just look at
yeah.
taser events or videos, you'll be able to see people that are being held by two people, and they already have the clips attached to them, and they're.
So, what happens with the teacher?
So with the taser, they'll attach what they call the alligator clips, because the little clips kind of look like an alligator's mouth. So they clip it to your skin. They'll pull the trigger, and you go for the ride. So a lot of people, it's not a pretty sight, because either they're writhing or they defecate themselves, because it relaxes your body. So
Wow.
people just either tense up, or they tense up, and then as soon as they're done, they release. So
So something latches on your skin and just is stuck there?
yeah, it's like like the clothespins,
Yeah.
kind of like that, attached with a wire to the taser gun.
So you can't even go through the like winter coat?
Probably not. It probably like if you would not want to deploy it on somebody's coat, because they'll have no effect. And even some people can not be affected by less than lethal. And that's why when people say like, well, why didn't they use a taser? Why didn't they use pepper spray? Why didn't they use a baton? You don't know what that police officer went through, because he might have used all three of them. And if this person's on some sort of a narcotic, some sort of drug, he may not feel it at all. And he just may be like pulling barbs out as he's getting tased. Pepper spray has no effect.
Really?
So one of the things that our trainer, when I was working at the base, he said like he's like, hey, because we all had to carry pepper spray. And he's like, so what do you use your pepper spray? Yeah, we use your pepper spray. And he's done. He's like, so what if he's not done? Then you start thinking like, what do I do next? Like if he's not immobilized, I only had pepper spray. I didn't have a taser. I didn't have a baton. So I go from pepper spray to my handgun. I can't de-escalate. One of the most important things with security work and even law enforcement is de-escalating the situation. So if you can talk somebody into complying with what you want them to do, that's the best course of action. If you can't, and that person just doesn't want to listen to you, they're having a really bad day, and they just want to fight you, then it's you just you escalate your use of force. So hands, pepper spray, taser if you're qualified for that, and then handgun.
Wow, so the physical force is the last resort. So for the current job or for your past jobs that you've had, what are the certification or any training or education process that you actually went through for that purpose?
So for the state of California, I had to go through their guard card course. For the current position that I have, I had received what's called I'm a cleared American Guard. It's actually the title that I hold, and I had to go through a class that our company has been developing with the Department of Defense to be used on a possibly on a for the So you have the Department of Defense, you have the Department of State. So our work is in with the Department of Defense and trying to make that accredited across all Department of Defense work. So it's also I took another course. It's called the Construction Surveillance Technician course. Basically, you're watching people do construction, make sure they're not putting any nefarious audio recording, video recording devices, information transmitting devices. That's actually one of the things I watch out for, because basically what I do is when somebody comes into my what I call the screening area, I'm just checking them like you would be going through an inch home. I work with an X-ray machine. I work with a metal detector. People walk through. I'm just making sure that they're not bringing anything that they're not supposed to bring onto our site.
Wow.
Making sure they're not bringing cell phones, they're not bringing any recording devices, any type of anything that they could build on site into a transmitting device. It's just about making sure that it's all they're just coming on with their tools, not even material, like just they're coming on with tools to work.
Wow. So how long did it take for you to complete each course?
So the guard car course was 40 hours, and then every year you had to continue, do another 8 hours of continuing education. For the course that I just did, I took the course after I got hired. It was something that they could do. They looked at my experience and they said, "Oh, you have a lot of what we're looking for already. We'll hire you and then we'll train you."
Oh, I see.
But a lot of it was on the job training. Didn't really have to do a whole lot with the actual in-class portion of it.
Oh, I see. So, in order to be involved in security work, or something similar that you're doing, it requires relatively short training, but you just have to do it well and love your job.
Right. For my specific job, you actually have to be a United States citizen.
Okay.
Have a what's called a security clearance. So they basically do an extensive background check on you and make sure that you're a honest person.
Wow, that's actually, I think that's the most important qualification, because if you're a bad person and if you have all those things, you can misuse them.
Right. You can be what's called an insider threat. I don't know if you ever watched the movie called Breach. It talks about an FBI person, a person that worked for the FBI, and he had, need to know, he had a clearance and he had the ability, and he was selling information to the Russians. He would basically take information from work, hide it in a newspaper, and drop it off. He'd have different drop-off points that his handlers would contact him at. And during that time, a lot of agents were killed because of his actions. So it wasn't anything very simple. It wasn't just him making money. People died because of his actions. And if anybody wants to go out and watch the movie's called Breach.
So that
And it
movie
talks about it.
is based on a true story, or is everything factual?
Everything is factual. It's based on a true story. It's not a documentary, but it's
Okay.
based on a true story, and they stay pretty true to it.
Okay. So when you watch those movies, do you feel like it's just too dramatic, or do you feel like it's still pretty accurate?
A lot of what, like, let's say in that movie, for me, it was just very, I had no experience with anything like that, so for me, I was like, I have to take it at their word that that's
Okay.
probably how it happens. But just for me, it's my interaction with security at Incheon Airport. Knowing what they're looking for, making their job easier. I know that I need to walk slowly through the metal detector so that the metal detector can detect what's on me, because if I walk through fast, it's going to set it off and they're going to have to check me anyways. One of the biggest things for me is I'm used to using walk-through metal detectors, but we also use what are called hand wands. So if for some reason they walk through my metal detector and I detect something, they still have metal on them, I'll have them proceed forward and I'll have them extend their arms out and I'll go over their body with a handheld metal detector to see if I find anything. Sometimes they forgot a gum wrapper.
Gum wrapper.
You know that, you know, like the Wrigley's gum with like aluminum.
Yeah.
They'll set it off, and
really?
So I have to. I have to, because it's my responsibility. It's my job to make sure that I'm doing a thorough job and not allowing anything that's not supposed to be there on. And usually stuff that I'm looking for is metal or silicone, like transistors.
Wow. So how do they know you have a clean background? What are the things they actually look into?
So they look into my job history. They look into my credit history. They'll contact friends, neighbors, prior employers. They'll do a thorough background looking to make sure that I'm a trustworthy person and that what I put down is accurate and compared to real world. They're not looking for good people, because there's, how can I explain that? There's good people that have done bad things.
Yeah.
Like they've made a mistake.
Yeah.
But they were honest about it and they came forward about it.
Yeah.
Depending on what it was,
yeah,
they might let it slide.
Yeah.
So it's not about finding the, like, you know, sparkling clean individuals.
I see. So when you say credit report, like your credit card history, or like how much money you owe and you didn't pay back and all these
mm-hmm.
things?
Basically, if I have any outstanding debts, because normally what happens with outstanding debt is if somebody's trying to get you to be an inside person or trying to get you to do something for them, they're going to either try to offer you money or they're going to cause you to slip up and you can get blackmailed. And basically, because you don't want the information that they have to come up to light, you know, you do something for them. So the U.S. government just wants to make sure that I'm not a person that can be bribed or blackmailed. Is
wow.
The two most important ones.
Well, I've never thought about that. I was only thinking about your integrity when it comes to money spending, but I guess it's more than that.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. So my last question is, what do you think about what happened to the guy that got choked by the police officer?
Are we talking about George Floyd?
Yeah, that guy, yeah.
Okay. That scenario is really controversial, because there was a lot more to the video. I don't know if you've actually had a chance to watch the full video
mm-hmm.
about what happened.
Yeah.
He actually asked to be placed on the ground. He's like, I can't be in this car. I need to get on the ground. I need to get on the ground. He was on something.
So he was kind of bullied.
He was freaking out, actually.
Oh.
He was on something, and he's like, I've had COVID and I can't breathe. And he's like, I need to get on the ground. I can't be in this car. I need to be on the floor. And so they put him on the floor. Now, where they totally messed up is you never put somebody, if they're in handcuffs, on their chest. It's not only, and obviously this officer, he put his knee on the guy's neck, so he's constricting his airway. And if he's already had the effects of COVID, he's already gone through COVID, his airways could be damaged. So that's an additional issue for Mr. Floyd. So, but the other thing that, one of the things I was always was taught when I went through that 40 hours of training was you don't put somebody on their chest if they're handcuffed, because they will suffocate. They will slowly suffocate. As for Mr. Floyd's situation, I think his partners should have done the right thing and stopped that police officer. But they just stood by. And by the time they probably reacted or realized that Mr. Floyd was injured or he was already deceased by the time they were unresponsive by the time that they reacted. Or they tried to resuscitate him.
So you say he was on something. Does that mean he was drugged up?
Yeah, he was on drugs.
Really? Oh, I didn't know that. Well, why was he holding him so long?
Oh, on the ground?
Yeah.
Was it the 9 minutes?
Yeah, why does it keep like staying like that? I don't understand.
And that was a poorly trained police officer. But a police officer, you only hold somebody in that position to make them comply. As soon as you have compliance, you bring them up to a sitting position. Because as I said earlier, if you leave somebody on their chest, or obviously you're constricting their artery, or excuse me, their airway, they're going to choke. I mean, it's 1 + 1 will give you 2. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. But if I were to put you in the cuffs and laid you on your chest, you would slowly suffocate because of your diaphragm.
So when you're on the cuff like this, so how does it affect your lung?
Because you're putting all that pressure. If you have your hands behind your back and you place yourself forward onto the ground.
Oh, like this?
You're on the ground. You'll slowly suffocate because of all the pressure that's being put on your lungs.
Yeah, I didn't really watch that thing too long. It was just too dark. I didn't know he was like that. I thought he was like this. So he was like this.
He wasn't on his chest. He was somewhat on his chest sideways, and they had the guy's knee was like approximately right here pressing.
Yeah.
I was giving an example of there's training that people are given.
Oh.
Of things not to do.
Okay.
And even departments have policies on this. Now, in New York now has passed the no choke. Their police officers are not allowed to do a neck choke. Kind of like an MMA move to, like,
okay,
make the person comply.
Okay. So he was poorly trained and he made a poor judgment.
Yeah, very poor judgment.
So, I still don't understand why he had to, like...
There's no explanation.
There's no explanation.
There's no excuse. There's no excuse.
It was being done.
That officer should not have had his knee on his neck for that long.
That's so terrible. Oh, actually, that's not the last question. So, was there a time when you have ever... conflicted in your conscience as a person that's involved in security industry because of your conviction on certain things?
So a lot of Seventh-day Adventists, I'm not on the Seventh-day Adventist Christian, practicing Seventh-day Adventist Christian, a lot of Seventh-day Adventists have an objection to the use of firearms. There's a whole movie about it. Hacksaw Ridge,
yeah.
with the story about Desmond Doss, and it talks about in that movie actually talks about two conflicts that I've had in my life, which are the use of a firearm, the taking of human life, and Sabbath keeping. In the security industry, obviously it's a 24/7 industry, so it can happen at any time, and you sometimes have to be ready to work. As for the discharging of a firearm and possibly taking somebody's life, I've come to the reasoning that I would be doing it to protect my own life and the life of others. It would not be a negligent discharge. So for me, I've chosen for myself and for the people that are around me to not be victims. And so that's a personal choice that I have made, that I will have to live with if for some reason I ever had to discharge a firearm.
I mean, when it comes to perfect pacifism, if somebody comes and try to kill my wife or harm an innocent person, if I just sit there and just watch because I believe in nonviolence, I don't know if that's something Gandhi or Jesus or really good people from the history would do. I think that you should get involved. You can't just watch them.
So one of the verses that's usually quoted is when Jesus rebukes Peter for cutting off the ear of Malchus, the temple servant.
Yeah.
Um, I don't see that as him rebuking Peter for the actual act. I personally have read that as him rebuking Peter of, you can't stop this.
Yeah.
This is going to happen.
Yeah.
You can't get in my way.
Yeah.
The same way when he calls Peter Satan,
yeah.
when he tells him, get behind me, Satan.
Yeah.
Ultimately, it's people's choices. I have a really good friend, Saul Castillo. He's a chaplain, and he himself has decided to not carry a firearm. He has somebody that's attached to him that carries a gun, but Saul himself has chosen to not carry a gun and not fire a gun. The other challenge that I've had is Sabbath-keeping. Like I said, the security industry is a 24/7, 365-day a year industry, and so. For me, I've had to make, for a while, I wasn't following what my conscience was telling me, and I would work on Saturdays, but there reached a point where I could not straddle the line anymore. I had to make a definite decision, and it hasn't been easy. In my current employment, I've had to fight to have Sabbaths off twice now. And also because of me not working on Saturdays or being willing to work on Saturdays, I've not been able to promote to the next step.
Wow.
Because the next step requires work when there's construction. So if there's construction Monday through Saturday, 6 or 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Then I need the idea of the company is you need to know what you're trying to what you're applying for. Know what your job requires.
Wow.
So because of the what I'm in now, I can work. I'm working night shift right now, so. I'll be working tomorrow night, but I get to work Sunday through Fridays. Sunday through Thursday, excuse me.
Oh, I see.
And I have Fridays and Saturdays off.
Wow. So, what do they tell you when you say this is a Sabbath, typically?
Usually, the response that a lot of employers will try to tell people is, can you postpone your Sabbath? Is there any way you can make Sunday your Sabbath like every other Christian? And I tell them no. One of my favorite quotes is Martin Luther when he's before the diet at Worms. It's in the Great Controversy. And he says, to go against one's conscience is neither safe nor sane. So I try to tell my employers, you know, hey, I'm willing to work for you 6 days a week. All I need is one day off. And it's Sabbath. You hate to be that, you know, that squeaky wheel or that, you know, that nail that just needs to get hammered in, but it's taking a stand. And for me, I've come to the realization that at some point I may not have that fair treatment anymore and I may have to give up this industry. And so I'm using this industry to set myself up for whatever God has for me next. So.
Wow. That's great. So, you know, doctors and nurses and all these people say, yeah, they need me. Sickness, don't take the Sabbath off. And Have you ever thought about considering that as doing good, and how does that bother you in your conscience?
I had thought about that. One of the time that I mostly thought about that was in when I was looking at going to law enforcement and into corrections, or either for the California Patrol or working for the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. I was struggling with that, and I'd come to the understanding that, you know, yes. Some nurses work on Saturdays, some doctors work on Saturdays. Ultimately, I thought that that would be the choice that would be a decision between that nurse and that doctor and God. Like that's I can't speak to that. That's between them.
Okay.
And the same thing with for me for that, for law enforcement. But in this industry, I can't see myself justifying guarding a building and saying that it's, you know, I'm doing God's will, working in this. Now, I would say that when I was working for the camp meeting, I work Saturdays. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. I work Saturdays. Because Saturday morning, early Saturday morning, you're directing traffic. You're bringing, you know, all these people are coming from all over the Central California Conference to worship. They're driving long hours, and we're just making sure that they get to a parking spot so they can get inside and listen to hear the sermon. We're out walking around, patrolling, making sure all the little angelic Adventist little kids are not getting into trouble. And so there's no question. I worked on Sabbath the same way that the lady at the fellowship hall in most Adventist churches, she works on Saturday, making sure that potluck happens. So, like at our church at Pyeongtaek, those ladies are in there slaving away and making pasta and all kinds of other stuff for people late prior to COVID. But those ladies were straight up working. But that's between them and God. And my decision to work at camp meeting was between me and God. I saw it as me doing there. I saw it as me doing good for God, for my fellow church, my fellow believers.
I see. Yeah, I think it's a very sensitive issue, and this is something you are really accountable to the ultimate judge of the universe. Another question, sorry, this is really the last one. So, you know how Hexa Rich guy said, oh yeah, I'm gonna save lives while everybody's taking them. So, would you be hired? Would they even consider hiring you if you say, okay, no gun?
At camp meeting?
Oh, no, for the security work. So in general, like, is that...
You can pick... That's, I guess that's the beauty of security work, is you can pick and choose what work you want to do. So if you... And the easiest way to get out of working armed security, don't get the qualification, don't buy a gun. If you don't have the qualification, you don't have a gun, you can't work as an armed security officer. So every person has their own choice of what they want to do. So there's no requirement for you to carry a handgun. But you have to know what the job that you're applying to requires of you. So if you're applying to transport money, be prepared that you need to get the firearm qualifications and you need to learn to fire a gun, because it's more likely you're going to have to carry one.
So if somebody says, I'm a pacifist and I don't believe in any violence, but I would like to work for this job, so you are discriminating against me because you're requiring me to carry a gun. Is there such a case?
There's not, because it's not a discrimination, but it's a requirement of the job. So it's not, you can't be considered. So for example, me promoting, this happened. There's a case with Walmart, where a Seventh-day Adventist, applied to, be the store manager for Walmart. He wanted Saturdays off, and Walmart looked at him like, we need you to work Saturdays. You have to work Saturdays. So what Walmart did was they offered him a lower position. They didn't require him to work Saturdays. He didn't want that position because obviously it pays less money. So he sued Walmart. Walmart won. You think about it and you're like, what? Walmart won? Walmart won. The reason that they won is because they offered him a job. He applied for one, did not meet the qualifications of that job. They gave him a different option for a job. And they, even though it pays less, they gave him a job. He chose not to take it. That's on him. So nobody can be forced or, and also there's no, you can't, if that's not a, that's not a discrimination because it's not necessarily a, what's called an ELO. So it's not about like their race or their ethnicity or the lack of English skills. That's a requirement of the job. It's something that can be compromised.
Wow.
If you don't have a job, just there's a different job.
I see. Wow. Thank you, Sam. I haven't thought about all these things, and I think I learned so much from you.
Glad I was able to help and to give you a little bit of insight into the kind of work that I do. It's not all fun and games, but there are certain cool things that you get to do. I'll give you just two brief ones that I did.
Sure.
Have you ever heard of Stan Lee?
Somebody famous?
Stan Lee, he created the Marvel Universe. So Spider-Man, Iron Man. So we did security protection for him for a concert that he was at. And then we got to do security work at Oprah's house.
Oh, okay.
In Goleta. So.
Oprah's house?
Oprah?
Oh, the African-American lady?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Wow. How was that?
She's a. I didn't have personal interaction with her because we were just doing security work. But I had some people that did interact with her said she was very nice. But she was busy. She was having a party.
Wow. So that's the two important people that you're actually work on.
Actually, my favorite person was two additional people, which was Elon Musk, obviously the owner of SpaceX, the owner of Tesla.
Oh.
So when I worked there, we had a launch, and he was geeking out to the site, checked everything out.
Oh.
And then the CEO of SpaceX, Glenn Shotwell. She's a. If you ever get a chance, there's a good documentary on YouTube about her. She is a very inspirational woman.
Oh, really?
She's hardworking. She's the one that gets all the contracts. So she's the one that's like, Elon Musk gets all the publicity. He gets all the hype about, you know, they recently had Starship. The Starship crash where it came down and went up into the atmosphere and then came back down and crashed. But she's the one that got all the contracts for NASA. NASA in this last year has delivered astronauts to the International Space Station. Mm-hmm. So first with SpaceX Dragon capsule. I got to guard that. That was super cool.
Wow. What made it cool though?
You're seeing history. I literally sat in a parking lot and guarded this capsule because they needed to do the parachute test.
Oh.
And I'm seeing history. I went up and touched it. And it's a really cool experience to have, to see where humanity's going. Obviously, you know, we know our, you know, there's that saying that, you know, we're just passing through here.
Yeah.
Because our ultimate goal, our ultimate home is heaven. But still, until then, I like the idea of the possibility of exploring this finite galaxy that we're in, the possibility of going to Mars. So, or even the moon, you know. You never know when you're going to need security on the moon. Sign me up. Sign me up. I'm number one on the list.
Wow, so you were all in cool places because you have to guard many important people and many important things.
I had that opportunity. I mean, I wouldn't even say a blessing because it was just a side thing, but it was just a cool thing that I got to experience.
Wow. Even though I see the person that is protesting in front of the Pyeongtaek military base saying, U.S. military, get out of here, but I really appreciate you guys doing all the work to protect this country from the potential threat up there. So I'm thankful that you're all the way here.
If I would have looked back 10 years ago, I never would have thought that I would be in South Korea. I'd be in my fourth year of living here in South Korea.
Yeah.
This Korea has treated me well.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful country, and hopefully I'd like to meet that 10 years. I'd like to do 10 years here if I can. So hopefully our company's getting more work and hopefully we'll be here a lot longer.
Okay, that'll be good.
Yeah.
Thank you for spending time with our viewers and with me.
Yeah, for sure.
And I think I'll get that documentary from you. Link.
Yeah. And I'll look it up and I'll send it to you.
Sure, and I'll let you know when I visit next time in Pyeongtaek.
Yep, for sure.
Yep.
So,
Thank you, Sam.
all right, man. Have a good evening.
Have a good evening.
Later, bye.
Yep, bye bye.
All right.
Bye bye.